Hey, how's it going? It is Friday, April 24th, and this is the Morning Star Drive on 117.8. We're on YouTube, so make sure to subscribe, follow us on SoundCloud, and make sure to support us on Patreon. Today, we're going to get some coronavirus updates. Also, the effects of the coronavirus already starting to show in the oil industry, and a member asked how I got my vision in life. So, how are you guys doing? What's so good about today? Today is Friday. And that, you know what that means? It's the weekend, and it's so good that it is the weekend already. I'm just thankful for all of you joining the Morning Star Drive today. Now, I just want to remind everyone to keep liking and commenting, and I want to hear from you guys and see how you're doing. And also, this week, it is the Sunday edition, and I'll be interviewing a filmmaker and screenwriter from Singapore, Jonathan Chu. You get to see the faith and the world through the mind of a filmmaker, and it's great. And you get to see one of the movies that he made, too. Well, it's not going to be on the thing, but we'll give you the links for it, but you'll see the trailer for it. Really good, I saw it. So let's get into the featured artist today. Today's featured artist is the Somni Boys, but we're going to listen to a new song called Trust the Process. So I asked the Somni Boys, how'd you get this song? And they said they were inspired, right? The song was inspired about how everything great is built little by little, day by day. Nothing comes all at once. So can you guess what they were, you know, what made them inspired by this? It was the Ambition masterpiece. It was built over 10 years, and then even now it's constantly being upgraded. And in the same way, we also have to build ourselves. The second song we're going to listen to is from the Paper Music Associates. It's from Isomers, and their single is LYL, or Live Your Life. So I hope everyone just relax and enjoy the music today.
So still in the game, I'm taking the pain. Look, my problems in life help me learn who I am. I made myself to be better than them. I never look back, I want to advance. You wish it was easy, like it is to go. Nothing happens overnight, it's too slow. Accepting the grind, cause we train all the time. Hey, look, you feeling the feet, that's all in your mind. In your mind, ay, you're in control. Nobody touching you. You got to know the future's coming. It happens now. I put in that work. Don't count me out. Trust.
Take it right from me. I worry a lot about my future, but I know that it's a process. Everything is God's time, and so I'm living life, trusting the process, ayy.
Trust in the process. No guilty conscience. Judge when I'm done. Don't count me out. Look where I'm at. Look where I came. Trust the process. I'm not the same. Look where I'm at. Look where I came. Trust the process. I'm not the same.
LYL, Live Your Life from Isomers, from the Paper Music Associates. And of course, that first song was the featured artist of the day. It was the Sumney Boys with their song, Trust the Process. So let's get into the coronavirus updates. A couple of things that we're going to look at today. We're looking at about almost 2.7 million cases around the world and about 185,000 deaths. And like I said before, if we're not really even sure how many deaths China really has, or Russia or Iran. So, you know, just in my thinking, we're well over 250,000, maybe even closer to 300,000 deaths. But that's just my thinking, right? But It's at 2.7 million reported and 185,000 reported deaths. Okay, so let's take a look at the U.S. And the U.S. is, you know, slowly moving up. They're at 850,000 cases, which means they're moving slowly towards the 1 million case mark. And they have 48,000 deaths. But of course, we know that per capita, their mortality rate is only at about 5.6%. It's about 5.6, which is still pretty good. See, Spain, Italy, France, the UK, they're all over 10%. And of course, the UK and, well, UK, Italy, and France are all roughly around 13.4 to 13.5, UK being the worst. But Spain's at 213,000 cases with 22,000 deaths. Italy has 187,000 cases with 25,000 deaths. And France is 157,000 with 21,000 deaths. And then the highest we have is the UK. Well, the highest percentage is 135,000 cases with 18,000 deaths. A couple of the countries that are just constantly moving up, we talked about this yesterday too. Turkey is about 1,000 away from 100,000, so they're right there. But their death rate is actually not too bad. They're around 2%, 2 point something percent. But they have 99,000 cases with about 2,300 deaths. Russia, on the other hand, as they move up a lot in cases, they're at 63,000 cases. Their deaths are reported to be like 500 plus. But we're not really sure how many there really are, right, with that many cases going on. Singapore, they're constantly moving up in the cases, but their deaths are relatively low. Like, it's under 1%. I think they have around a little over 11,000 cases at the moment. And their cases keep going up 10% at a time. I think it was like 4 or 5 straight days of 1,000 cases. But deaths remain the same at 11, okay, which is quite ridiculously low. But, you know, I was there in Singapore when it first started too. They're really, really good at this, like locking down, and everyone takes good measures for it. Malaysia's kind of interesting because we heard some news just last night where the Prime Minister came on TV and he said that the lockdown will be for another 2 more weeks because the holy month, like, guys got to know that Malaysia is an Islamic state. So what's happening is next month is supposed to be like a holy month. And the hard thing about that is that's when lots of people start to gather. So I do believe we're going another 2 weeks until May 14th around there. And part of it is to stave off this big gathering so that we don't have another flare up, a second wave, right? And Malaysia is pretty good right now because they have 5,600 cases with only 95 deaths. So they're like at 1.7%, and it's been like this for a while. Like, things haven't been going up. Like, the cases go up maybe 1%, and it's not even that much. I think even yesterday there's only like 50 or 60 cases that were found. So I'm really hoping that things are slowing down here and we don't have to go through another lockdown or anything like that. New York, of course, in the U.S., New York is like the most hardest hit state by far, because they have like 270,000 cases with 20,000 deaths, which is basically more cases in Spain and about the same amount of deaths as France, right? So that's how bad that one state is. But like they said, we've been reporting about this too. It's kind of flattening out over there, even though it's flattening out at a very, very high rate. The good thing is it is flattening out. So what did I want to talk about today? Today I'm talking about something that's like a really crazy thing that just happened. I talked about how the coronavirus, like the effects of the coronavirus is already, like you can already start to feel it, and the oil industry is really feeling it. And there's like a bunch of different reasons why it's happening. But like yesterday or 2 days ago, oil went negative. You know, basically that means is these oil companies are paying you to take their oil. It was minus $37, right? Companies are paying you to take their excess oil. And you know, the reason why the coronavirus is has a huge effect on this, because no one's outside. No one's driving their cars. No one's flying. Right, no one's going on cruises. Businesses are closed, so oil is not being used. And they say they cut the world demand on oil, cut down a third. Right, so this is kind of why there's so much supply going on, but no demand. And if you kind of look at like how the oil industry works, one of the bigger problems is even before this was happening, like this big negative thing that happened in America with the oil prices, there was already like an oil war going on between Russia and Saudi Arabia, and both these countries are like kind of overproducing and just flooding the market with excess oil. And like, if you understand what that means, is if they keep flooding the market, the price of oil goes down. And the reason why that's so bad for countries like Russia, America, and Canada is like Saudi Arabia produces the cheapest oil. Their cost of producing oil is about $10 a barrel, where Russia, Canada, and the U.S. all produce 20 or more. It's over $20, which means that if these countries want to stay like these oil companies want to stay in business, the price of a barrel has to stay above $20 basically in order for them just to break even. But you know, think how bad it is. It went to minus $37 at one of the I don't know if it's the biggest, but it's happening in it happened in America, right? So Russia and Saudi Arabia were having this war, right? And they're both of them just kept flooding the market even though the coronavirus was going in. So like we said, the coronavirus caused like a third of demand went down because of the coronavirus. So, you know, last week Trump went in, talked to the Saudis and talked to Russia and said, hey guys, you know, we gotta lessen this out. Because, you know, what happens is they're the one flooding the markets. And, you know, and those are like they're the two biggest, like the two biggest oil giants, right, in the world. And basically they're causing other companies to, you know, other countries to kind of go, you know, like almost like bankrupt them in the oil industry. But Trump went in and he put in a deal where both Russia and Saudi Arabia will produce or not put out 10 million barrels, okay? So there's 10 million less barrels being put out, which means that America can sell 10 million more. The problem is the U.S. output is 30 million barrels, which means that only 10 million is being able to be used. So you have 20 million extra barrels. And they said all the storage is filled up, which means no one wants the oil. There's nowhere to put this oil, and that's why they are paying people to take their oil. Nobody wants it because no one is driving. No one is flying. You wouldn't even be able to use it anyways. The good thing is the next day, which was yesterday, oil started at around $1.10 a barrel, which is terrible because remember, it takes for the U.S., it's about $22 a barrel, $20 to $24 a barrel that the U.S. produces at, but it's at $1.10 right now, which is better than minus 37, right? So, you know, all the things that we're feeling right now from the coronavirus, it's very, very short term at the moment. But we do have to know that there are major long-term effects that are going to happen. And even when the economy gets back up, we all know that people are not going to be rushing to the restaurants. Everyone is going to come back cautious. Few people are still not going to go out. Few people go to restaurants, to the malls and whatnot. So people are going to be very cautious in the beginning. And also remember that to see the true effect of this economic like crisis right now, they say it'll take anywhere from a year to 2 years before you see the actual results of this financial crisis. So it might not even be that bad in the beginning, and we might think to ourselves, oh, it's not too bad, but you're not going to feel it until about 2 years later. They said one scary thing is at the moment, because of this oil crisis, you know, this oil crisis right now, they say it's possible that maybe more than 500 companies could go bankrupt in the U.S. because of it. So, you know, that's kind of some things that we have to think about and understand that, yeah, this is a real serious thing, and we have to understand that we really need to pray for it and make sure that everything, you know, in the most reasonable and best way can come back to normal, and we can see everything, like hopefully the economy comes back and less people will be affected with depression, suicide, and whatnot too. Okay, so that brings us to the praise portion, and I know that a lot of us want to praise too. We're going to sing two songs, and the first song is requested from last Sunday's Sunday Edition interview, Brianna Ruiz, and she wants to hear the song White Lily of the Holy Land. So we can sing that song together. And then the second song, Oldie But a Goodie, OBG, right? Without the Lord, I can't live on. Thank you.
Breathe.
Without the Lord, I can't live on. That's an oldie but a goodie. I hope you guys really enjoyed that song. And of course, that very first song that was requested from Brianna Ruiz, which was last Sunday edition interview, was White Lily of the Holy Land. Now, that brings us to like the word section of this podcast. One question that someone gave me, actually, two people gave me this question in the same week, which is really interesting. And the question is, how did you find your vision in life? Right? How did you find your vision in life? And they just wanted to hear where I found my vision, because I actually talked about this, I believe, on Tuesday. It was either Saturday, last Bubble Talk. I believe it was a Bubble Talk, or it was... No, it was a Bubble Talk, yeah. During the Bubble Talk, I talk about how necessary a vision in life is. And they asked me, how did I find my vision? Because I did say in the Bubble Talk that I had some type of experience. And for a lot of you who come from Christianity, like were born in Christianity, for myself, there's something that we all know. And those of who are not, you know, who didn't come from Christianity, you may not know this, but there's something called a calling. And there's a calling. And it's just something like something happens in your life. Whether it's an experience, but through that experience, you feel God calling you to do something, calling you to ministry, calling you to become a missionary, calling you to do something. And I had my calling when I was about 20, when I just turned 20 years old. And I'll just kind of go through like what happened to me to get my calling to do what I'm doing right now. Like not the podcast, but you know, just how my life for the last 22 years has been. Well, first of all, I just, you know, everyone, we have to understand how necessary a vision in life is. It is absolutely necessary for everyone. In order for us to move forward, we have to have something we're moving forward towards. So you got to think about it. If you're in a boat, if you don't know where you're moving and you just kind of float, you just kind of move with where the waters take you. And that's what a lot of people happens to some people is they feel like they're just floating and wherever the tide takes me, I'm going. And that's a lot of people are kind of living in that way. But we have to realize... you got to have a vision, something in the future that, something big, something that you really, really want. And something big, like there has to be something that moves you towards a certain direction. And for many of us in this history, in Providence, we're uncertain what we want to do and where we want to go at times. And for one of the biggest choices we make, especially those coming from campus, I'm sure everyone who kind of struggles with this, everyone's been through this before. If you came to Providence when you're in campus, it's the choice between, oh no, I graduated now, so should I run for God in the church or should I run for God in a job? And both are equally important and both are equally valuable. So for myself, I really understood my future vision when I was about 20 years old, about my second or third year in university. And at that time, I was just evangelized, right? So I was just turning 20, I was like 19, right? And, you know, I was just, all I was doing is just evangelizing. On campus, almost every day, just meeting people. And to be honest, I wasn't really sure what to say to people. I just kind of met people. I was really scared too. I just kept trying and trying until I found someone. And finally, I just ended up meeting some dude. And he actually said yes to Bible study. So, you know, overjoyed. I call my pastor like, hey, oh, I got this person wants to do Bible study. He said, oh. And then my pastor says he doesn't have time to come to campus. Not because he didn't want to, because he had four other campuses that he was lecturing at. So I was kind of like bummed out, like, oh my gosh, I'm so disappointed. But then he said, why don't you do it? You should teach. And I was like, serious? He's like, yeah, you should teach. You know, I can't make it, but you should prepare and teach. So I really took this challenge seriously. And this first lesson I prepared was Peter and the Fish. Even to this day, one of my favorite lectures. I guess because it's my first love, right? And I spent 4 days listening to 4 different people teach it, listening to tapes, though, and taking a lot of notes, putting my notes together and making a lecture, then standing in front of the leaders, like some of the lead, like the, my past, like 2 or 3 pastors in the church, I teach in front of them and they said they loved it. So I was like, all right, you know what? They probably said they loved it, even though it wasn't that good, because they wanted to give me confidence. And I don't care, because I got confidence from it, right? So on the day of the lecture, I go to school, confident. I teach this guy, Peter the Fish. And to be honest, there were some times I was so scared, like, oh shoot, what do I say next? But there was this moment. Like, there was this moment where I got my calling. And teach Peter the Fish. And you know how you're teaching the lesson? It starts to slowly reach towards the climax of the lecture. And it was just like, this climax comes in. Boom! And I looked at his eyes when I gave him that answer of the fish. And his eyes just opened really wide. And then I felt it. Like, I saw his eyes like physically open larger, but I can feel his spiritual eyes opening. And I've never experienced anything like this. And then the next feeling is, you might think it's like a movie, but the feeling I had was like the clouds opened, a light started to shine down on me, and then I felt like I could hear angels singing. I'm dead serious. That's how epic that moment was. I was just like, and then boom, his eyes go, and I was like, oh, and then I hear the singing, and I was like, oh my gosh. And at that moment, I said to God, this is what I want to do for the rest of my life. And from there, I haven't stopped. Like, I just kept running from that point on. Like, I had my calling at that point. At that point, I knew that even if when I graduate from university, I'm not going to be like, I was a business major, I'm not going to be doing business. And as a matter of fact, when I was on campus, I was just evangelizing and teaching, skipping classes. But, you know, I still passed. And it was a decent grades. Like, it was like a 3.33, which is decent. But, you know, I skipped so many classes and stuff. And I even purposely, my last semester, what I did was I purposely didn't take one course so that I can have one semester with just one course and just evangelizing all day. And, you know, at that time, you know, I think at one point I was teaching 4 times a week, 6 hours a day, 18 people. It was nuts and just on fire. And that's when I kind of saw my big direction for me running, you know, running for God in church. And that's where I got my direction for that. And to be honest, even then, I didn't even know what exactly I was going to do. I didn't know if I was going to be a pastor. I didn't know if I was going to be a missionary. I don't know. I have no idea. And to be honest, even right now, I only know what I'm doing right now. But I know that I'm supposed to be running in church. Like, that's my direction that God has given to me. So a couple things that you can that I realize from this is, first, you realize as you run. So there's no, like, for those of you in campus, you're running. You know, obviously people in campus should be running and studying in school and stuff like that and having fun doing all these other different things. But you never really realize it until you run. You put your life into it. You try it out. And during campus, while I was doing a part-time job, while I was at full-time school, I was just running. Yeah, just run whatever God wanted. I was evangelizing, started lecturing and teaching and everything else. And can the direction change in the future? Absolutely. But one thing I'm pretty certain about is you will never be able to get the calling until you're actually doing something. Like, for me, is I spent so much time preparing for that. And when I actually did it, you know, I had that moment of epiphany when I was 20 years old. And I knew that I was running for this history from that point on. The second thing I realized from this is I only got a very small direction. I had no idea what the big picture was. All I know is I was running, running for God in ministry for the church. And the only direction I got was lecture. And that's all I focused on. That's it. Lecturing and lecturing and learning and lecturing and constantly lecturing over and over and over and over again. That's all I did. And that was the first direction God gave me. The third thing I realized from this situation is I never knew what the step after would be. I only had a general direction. Like, so if I even look at my path as in this history, I start off as a newcomer. Then I went, you know, then I was evangelizing. And then I became a lecturer. Then I became a missionary, a pioneering missionary, like setting up churches. Then I became pastor of a church. And then, you know, even before becoming pastor of a church, I went to seminary school for 2 years. Then I became a pastor of a church. And then, like, now it's like I'm headquarters. And also, I'm like a missionizing pastor for Southeast Asia, which is like 5-6 countries. So, you know, to be honest, from there was nothing there like saying that, hey, guess what? You're going to be working in Southeast Asia 20 years from now, and you're going to be a missionizing pastor. Like, nothing like that. All I knew was I just had to be a lecturer. I got my direction, my big direction, though. And it's something that I think everyone else, the first thing people have to do is, in order to get your calling or to know which direction you're taking, you got to run it. And the vast majority of people will be working. Vast majority. Yeah, by far, vast majority will be working. So there's probably like an 80% chance you're going to be like working and you know, running for God in your jobs and such. But finding your calling, you know, I know this is a very religious terminology, and like Christians know this very, very well. But you will get your calling to the ministry, and whether it's leading in ministry, calling to ministry, some form. But for those of you out there who are looking for your calling and looking for that place, like, where am I supposed to go? If anything, when you're young and you have time, just run. Now, I'm not saying skip school and don't work. Just do all of it. You can. Why? Because you're young. You're young. You have so much energy. Just do it. I was part-time job, which was 20 hours a week at Coffee Bean as a barista. And then I was like full-time school. And the rest of my time was all just running for God. Evangelism, lecturing, and meeting people, stuff like that. That was basically my life. And I was able to get all three areas, from student to working to running ministry. And I got the calling for the one I really wanted. But the answer, like, you got to put everything in. If you don't put everything in, you won't see or you won't feel as big as it should be. Because one thing I do know is God is a fair God. And if God is very, very fair, then if you put in 30%, you'll get 30%. If you want that powerful feeling, you got to put in 100% to get 100% feeling. But if you put in 20%, the feeling is going to be 20%, which means you're unsure. You're not sure, because 20% is a very, very low number, right? So if anything, you got to put everything in, or you won't see or you won't feel anything happen. Yeah, and then even if it might be the right direction, you'll think you made a mistake and you're in the wrong place because you didn't fully put in. Whether you do ministry, whether you go to work, you know, when you're doing ministry, put your life on it. If you're going to work and you want to become a beacon of light to the people in the world, you got to put everything in. Do your best. Where people say, wow, this person's happy and he does well at work and he does this. And wow, this person's amazing. So whatever path you are led to, or whatever path you choose, you have to put everything in. And when you do this, this is when you get God's calling. And this is when you begin to feel what God really wants. Okay. So that is my story of calling. If you have any more questions, you can go ahead, write it in the comments. If it helped you out, put it in the comments too. This brings me to the song of choice. And this, oh man, I remember back in the days, probably back in like 2008 or 9 or 2007, maybe 2006 or 7, I was totally into gospel music, like crazy gospel music. And I was just listening to this song from Kirk Franklin. And then one of the first songs he came out with called Stomp. It was super famous. He was on like popular radio too. But there's one song from 2016. And this song is so fitting of this time. If you just listen to the intro, he said, this song is for those who are depressed. This song is for those that are unemployed. This song, you know, it basically is talking about this time right now. So when I was listening to it, like, oh man, this song is totally fitting. It is so fitting. Right? So what we're going to do is we're going to listen to this song. It's from Kirk Franklin, and it's called Smile. Okay? So just listen carefully to the lyrics. It's really, really like fitting. So let's sit back and enjoy Kirk Franklin, and the song is Smile.
I dedicate this song to recession, depression, and unemployment. This song's for you.
Today's a new day, but there is no sunshine. Nothing but clouds, and it's dark in my heart, and it feels like a cold night. Today's a new day, but where are my blue skies? Where is the love and the joy that you promised me? Tell me it's all right.
I'll be honest with you,
I almost gave up.
When I think how much better I'm gonna be when this is over.
I smile, even though I hurt, see I smile. I know God is working, so I smile, even though I've been here for a while.
What you do?
I smile.
Come on
in. Smile, it's so hard to look up when you've been down. Sure would hate to see you give up now.
God's people. Still don't mean today don't have purpose. Come on.
Today's a new day, but there is no sunshine. Nothing but clouds, and it's dark in my heart, and it feels like a cold night.
It ain't easy, bud.
Today's a new day, but tell me, where are my blue skies?
Where is that love, y'all?
Where is the love and the joy that you promised me? Tell me it's all right.
The truth is,
I almost gave up, but a power that I can't explain.
That Holy Ghost power, y'all.
Fell from heaven like a shower now.
Now I know we've been hurt, y'all, but still,
I smile.
Come on.
Even though I hurt, see, I smile.
Y'all feel that?
I know God is working, so I smile. Even though I've been here for a while,
still,
I smile.
Hallelujah. Whatever you're in right now,
smile for me.
Smile.
Can you just smile for me?
And my people say,
oh, 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 you look so much better when you're.
Remember,
you look so much better when you smile.
Come on.
I almost gave up.
I almost gave up. But the Holy Ghost power, y'all,
fell from heaven.
Came down from heaven. Hardships, difficulties,
right now.
Tears, storms. This is what I do.
I smile.
Woo.
Even though I hurt, see, I smile.
Boy, that feels good.
I know God is working, so I smile.
All things are working.
Even though I'm
right now.
Sure would hate to see you give up now.
Because you're a winner.
You look so much better when you smile.
You look better.
So smile. Oh, oh, oh.
Dallas.
You look so much better when you. Oh, oh.
New Orleans.
You look so much better when you. Oh,
come on.
Oh, oh.
Cleveland.
You look so much better when you. Oh, oh.
Detroit.
You look so much better when
yeah.
I want you to be happy, 'cause then you gotta have something happen. I want you to have joy, 'cause cause can't nobody take that from you. I see you smiling.
And that was Kirk Franklin with Smile. Hope you guys enjoyed that song. It's like perfect, right? It says this is dedicated to recession, depression, and unemployment. So that brings us to one of the favorite parts for a lot of us here, and this is story time, right? This is a time where we can listen to stories from people around the world. And today's story is actually coming from LA. Okay, and this is from one of our listeners in LA. His name is Mason. And amazing story. Okay, we got to listen to this. Really, really amazing. And this happened last year. So let's listen to Mason's story. So last year, I wanted to go to Korea with the largest American group ever assembled. But I wasn't making enough money, and I wasn't spending the money wisely either. So I began to pray and I asked God if it was the will for him to go or not. So I started to spend less and I really prayed for God's help. I was talking to my grandmother one day and I evangelized her. And I told her I was planning to go to Korea. So she wanted to help me and I said it was okay. But she gave me $500. It covered half my airfare. So I got my ticket in time, I packed my bags, and I went to Korea. And as I was boarding, I passed by this kids' play area in the airport, and there was this whiteboard with these magnetic letters on it, and it said, God loves you. I smiled so brightly, and I told the Trinity, I love you too. So I got on the plane and I sat next to this Filipino grandmother and we just started talking and talking and talking and talking 1 hour, two, three, and it just kept talking deeply. And the conversation just kept getting deeper and deeper. And then we ended up talking about God. She was a very devout Christian and I was moved, so I started to share the word with her. And basically, I shared like 5 Sunday sermons with her. And then she looked at me, and then she pulled out some money, and she gave it to me. And the amazing thing was in that week's message, it said that if you get money, just put it in your pocket, don't count it. So I just put it in my pocket, I didn't count it. But then she said, go count it. I need to make sure it's right. And then we counted and she gave me another $20. She gave me $200. And she even wants to come to church with her husband. And that's not it. I was in Korea now. And we found out there's a Holy Spirit movement going on in Taiwan. And I planned to go. And then all of a sudden, my church decides to pay for my ticket to Taiwan. So I got a free ticket. 2 days before the actual event, I was in Korea, and 2 days before flying out, the pastor whose house I'm staying at wanted to talk to me, and he said he was praying for me, and he was really inspired to help me, and he gave me $200. Wow, God really blessed me financially during this trip, and I realized how much God really takes care of us. You see, even after getting back from this trip, I quit my job. And God gave me an even better job. You see, one thing I really believe is that God allowed me to gain these financial blessings because of one thing. It's because I never missed tithing. I really felt that all these tithings I did for the last 4 or 5 years really added up to this blessing. So I'm very grateful and thankful. Wow, I hope you guys are moved and inspired by this. I know that even right now, a lot of people are going through financial difficulties and troubles because of the coronavirus and the lockdowns. But we need to trust in God. We don't know what the outcome is going to be yet. And I know it's hard at this moment, but we have to be the ones that still trust and rely on God. Because we are His brides and because God loves us so much, we have to trust that everything is going to be okay. We just don't know what the outcome is going to be yet, We got to trust it's going to be okay. All right. So thank you so much, Mason. Wonderful and amazing story. And the cool part was, like, I was there. Like, I was at the same house with him. So he stayed with us too. And now I know, like, how this all happened. I went to Taiwan with him too. So it was really, really cool. So I hope you guys enjoyed today's show. I hope you guys have an amazing, amazing weekend. Remember that tomorrow is the Bubble Talk. So please join us. I believe it'll start at 8 p.m. tomorrow on the Facebook page. Which brings us to the end of today's podcast. Thank you for joining us on the Morningstar Drive on 117.8. I hope you guys have an amazing weekend. Enjoy the Bubble Talk. Enjoy service on Sunday. See you guys later.
Believe in yourself and believe it's with somebody.
Gotta believe in yourself.
Cause
no one else will.
You the people have the power.